Greetings, everyone, and welcome to today's webinar. The role of proficiency testing in laboratory quality assurance. Great to have all you here with us. I'm Sharif Mehmeti, the account manager of quality management system here at PECB and organizer of this webinar. The webinar will be presented by Mr. Dehnad, PECB certified trainer and CEO at Pasargad Quality Pioneers. Please feel free to write your questions and comments in the question box in the right-hand control panel, or you can use the raise hand function. We will unmute you and you will have a chance to ask the question directly to Mr. Dehnad. He will answer to all questions accordingly at the end of the presentation. Please, Mr. Dehnad, you may continue with your presentation.
Okay, thank you very much. Hello, everybody. This is Hamidreza Dehnad, and as mentioned, my today's presentation will be about the role of proficiency testing in laboratory quality assurance. First of all, let me briefly introduce myself. I have been involved in the, as you can see in this slide, I have been involved in the field of laboratory accreditation for more than 12 years now. As different functions, laboratory quality manager, trainer and consultant of different laboratories in different industries. This is also my contact information. I hope that my today's presentation will be useful for all of you. As you may probably know, proficiency testing at the moment is the most important and most advanced techniques which can be used by the laboratories to demonstrate their competency to different interested parties, including accreditation assessors or managers of the laboratories or other stakeholders in an organization. As you can see, we have different quality assurance tools. First of all is using of certified reference materials, materials which are quite homogeneous and stable and well characterized. Validated methods, different types of test methods which are made used by laboratories around the world, published by well-recognized organizations such as ISO or ASTM or different organizations. The other one is PTs or proficiency testing, which is quite different from other tools mentioned here because this provides you with an independent evaluation. If later on we will have the definition of proficiency testing, but at this point, proficiency testing is the evaluation of the laboratory performance through interlaboratory comparisons. And throughout these recent years, this concept has been developed in different areas. Many laboratories in different industries participate in proficiency testing, not for the purpose of accreditation only, but for other areas, and this is what we call external quality assurance techniques, because the evaluation, the assessment is done by an external party, which is called PT provider or proficiency testing provider, an organization who performs these activities. We also have some tools such as internal quality control, which are not the subject of today's presentation. Okay. Why laboratories should participate in proficiency testing programs or participate in other interlaboratory programs or comparisons? As you can see, the most important objective is to provide an indication about the laboratory performance, to confirm the laboratory produces valid results. So, in proficiency testing, we participate in a program and we receive an unknown sample, which is unknown to us. And we perform the test on this sample and submit our results to the PT provider. And then PT provider evaluates our results comparing with an assigned value. This assigned value can be a reference value, can be a consensus value, can be a value derived by formulation or other techniques which can be used for definition or establishment of assigned values. Group of laboratories in internationally usually participate in proficiency testing. And the most important point is that the laboratory should treat the sample as a routine sample. You know, additional care should not be taken to a proficiency testing sample because it's a control sample. You should provide a routine condition for this, similar to other samples that we analyze in the laboratory on a daily basis. Proficiency testing helps laboratories to improve their quality. So with the means of quality of proficiency testing, they can identify the problems in their measurement system. The problem is the calibration. Sometimes the problem is from the personnel incompetency, sometimes from the environmental condition in the laboratory, or from the materials that we use in our laboratory. So laboratory can identify the problem and improve the quality of its system, as we have in many tools in quality management systems to improve. And there is another advantage in participation in proficiency testing, that we can provide our interested parties, as I mentioned, with an objective evidence about the competence of the laboratories. These interested parties can be customer, regulatory bodies, accreditation bodies, or other interested parties who may want some information about the quality of or the performance of the laboratory. Okay, proficiency testing are not very expensive in the world compared with certified reference materials. So it's an affordable means for the laboratory to verify its capability for performing the test. Other advantages of proficiency testing is, for example, here we mentioned that we will be confident about our performance in the laboratory. Okay, let me go to the next slide. Okay. Usually in proficiency testing, only the accuracy or the trueness of the laboratory can be assessed. For assessing the precision of the laboratory or precision of our results, there are other means that we may use. For example, we can repeat a test in a constant condition in order to evaluate the repeatability or our intermediate precision between our laboratories. So usually proficiency testings are in place in order to help us identify systematic problems in our laboratory. What is a systematic problem or systematic error? An error which is constant in the repetitions, in replicates in the laboratory. It means that there is a problem in my laboratory that I cannot do anything about it. It exists. A technician doesn't know how to perform a test. My instrument provides or produces wrong results, and they're constant over time. So proficiency testing is a very good tool for me to identify the problem. Okay. And when I uncover this error, I can find the opportunity for improvement in my laboratory. So let me summarize up to this point. As I mentioned in proficiency testing, there are some unknown samples sent to laboratories by a central PT organizer. Laboratories perform the test, and then afterwards the evaluation will be assessed comparing it with an assigned value, and I mentioned how to establish this assigned value. But there are some limitations in proficiency testing. For example, in some cases we don't have representative samples. What do I mean? That the samples that are used in proficiency testing are not similar to my routine samples. There are certain cases in proficiency testing that there is no stable sample in a real matrix, or because of the stability of the analyze that we measure in our sample, it is not possible for the provider to provide us with real samples. So a sample which is not similar to our case is sent to my laboratory. Another problem is the retrospective nature of proficiency testing. It means that first there should be a problem in my laboratory, and then through proficiency testing I can identify it. It means that proficiency testing is only a source for performing corrective actions in the laboratory. Sorry. Okay, and in some area, in some tests, in some industries, we don't have any good and well-organized proficiency testing within our industry, and that would be the case that we should have. We have to find other means to assess laboratory performance. Okay, let's go briefly through the different stages of proficiency testing. First, the PT body. This is the first item is the task of the PT body or PT organizer, preparing the test material. So it should be characterized, it should be checked for homogeneity, it should be checked for stability. And then after we assure the homogeneity and the stability of our sample and establish the assigned value, the distribution of test materials is being done. In this case, we should consider some issues. For some samples which are sensitive to different environmental conditions, some additional transportation consideration should be in place. For example, shipping under dry ice or similar items. And the other issue that there should be instructions for the participants to know how to prepare the sample. You know, these instructions should not have any information about the test method, because the laboratory should perform the test based on their own method, not the prescribed method by the proficiency testing provider. So then the test performed by the participants in laboratories, and then the results are sent to the proficiency testing organizer, and they should perform some statistical evaluations. Usually they calculate a score called the Z-score, very famous. The Z-score is an index for a laboratory to know about its accuracy and trueness in the laboratory. And then the laboratories, the participants are notified by the provider about their scores. And they go through how to interpret that score, and then proficiency testing body review the outcomes of the scheme. Okay. How we should establish the, or how proficiency testing providers establish the true value or assigned value. Sometimes they use CRMs, certified reference standards, or reference material. In that case, the certified value is known in advance. I mean, before distribution of the samples, we know which is the assigned value. Sometimes this value, the assigned value, is the consensus value by the expert laboratories. I mean that we have selected some laboratories that we are sure about their accreditation, their calibration of the instruments, the quality, the competence of their personnel. So based on the results of this group of expert laboratories, we specify the assigned value, which is a very good method, but it can be expensive in some cases. The last one, which is common between PT providers, is using the participants' consensus value. It means that before distribution of the samples, we have no information about the true value or the consensus value. And after receiving the results from all the laboratories, we should perform, we should analyze, and we should calculate the assigned value. We should be very cautious with this approach, that if a considerable part of the participants have systematic errors, maybe the calculated assigned value has the systematic error. And this is the performance score called Z-score. Z-score is calculated by comparing or the deviation of the results submitted by the laboratory. X here means the result of your own laboratory. And mu is the assigned value. In the last slide, we talked about how to calculate the assigned value. And then this value should be divided by the standard deviation. The standard deviation is the reproducible standard deviation, which can be a measure of how we expect the results to be deviated from each other. We call it standard deviation, and there are different techniques to excluding the outliers or using robust statistics to calculate this standard deviation. Okay, how to interpret the performance based on Z-scores? If the absolute value of the Z-score is below 2, it means that the laboratory performance is quite satisfactory. this is the case that we always look for. But if the Z-score here, it means the absolute value of the Z-score, because the Z-score might be positive or negative. Positive means that we measure with a value higher than the assigned value, and if it is negative, it means that we measure a value less than the assigned value. If the absolute value of Z is between 2 and 3, it means that we have a questionable performance. It means that our existing error in the laboratory is not considerable, that, for example, we have to stop the testing process. But we have to investigate the case. But if the absolute value of Z is higher than the 3 in this case, if the population is normal, sorry, the performance of the laboratory is considered unsatisfactory. In this case, we usually say that the laboratory should suspend its testing activities, testing process, in order to see what is the problem, because the results produced are not reliable anymore, and we should consider that in our quality management systems. And usually, PEC providers report this report with a chart like this. Sorry for the low quality, but the chart is like this. Laboratories are identified with some codes, A, B, C, as you can see in this slide. The real identity is not clear. It's a confidential matter only between the participant and the proficiency testing body. Okay, and then if the laboratory performance is not satisfactory, there should be a corrective action. The laboratory should investigate the case and should look for a root cause of the problem. There are different cases. For example, if we have one, because in proficiency testing, we have a system that this should be a continuous process. I mean that every season or every quarter, every year, we should participate in proficiency testing. And after a while, we can have a very good picture of how was our performance. For example, look to the bullet number 2. If we have at least 3 unsatisfactory results in one round for different parameters, there should be a corrective action in the laboratory. Or 2 consecutive unsatisfactory results for one analyte, then we should proceed with corrective action. As in all management systems, and as it is indicated in ISO 17025, first we should document the problem, decide if we need a corrective action. Then we should look for the root cause, and usually the accreditation assessors ask you to provide them with an evidence that the problem is solved. And usually this evidence is every participation in proficiency testing. It means that you have to participate again in the same PT program and show that, okay, at this time I have a good performance and this is the evidence, and all of the stages of this corrective action should be recorded. And also, we should also check for our internal quality control activity efficiency. It means that if there is a good internal quality control program in place, the result should be a good performance in proficiency testing. Otherwise, if the performance is poor in proficiency testing, we should go back to our internal quality control process to see what went wrong, what we did miss in our internal quality control program that made to an unsatisfactory result in the proficiency testing. Okay, another important issue in proficiency testing is confidentiality. As I mentioned, the identity of the laboratories should be confidential between the laboratory and the participant laboratory and the proficiency testing provider. If the identities are known, there might be some economic ruins for the laboratory, as I mentioned in this slide. And we should consider that in case of a legal regulatory body asks for the real identity of the participants, the PT provider has to provide information to the legal authority. Okay, another issue which should be considered by the proficiency testing provider is the collusion or falsification of results. It means that the participants' laboratories know each other. They call each other and they agree on a value to be reported sometimes. The majority of the results when it is we have such a case. So the proficiency testing provider should be very careful and they should have systems in place in order to avoid such a collusion or falsification. Okay. One of the tools for avoiding this case is provide different samples with different concentrations to the laboratories so they cannot call each other and check what is the result because the samples are different. Okay, let's go to see what are the benefits of the proficiency testing. It's a regular check of my quality in the laboratory. It's a tool for demonstrating our competence to interested parties, as I mentioned. It's a motivation to improve performance in my laboratory. It seems like a race to see if my laboratory is better than the other participant laboratories in a program. It's a support for our accreditation. Usually most of the well-known accreditation bodies in the world ask for providing them with the records of our proficiency testing. It's a comparison of performance with other laboratories in our industries. It's a good tool for identification of problems. It can help us to receive feedback and technical advice from the organizers of the proficiency testing in order to improve my system. It's a saving in time and cost if it prevents repeating of the measurement or it prevents the issuing of a false test results. Okay. And we cannot monetarily quantify the benefits of proficiency testing because sometimes it prevents a major loss in the laboratory. A major loss, I mean a loss in the image of my laboratory. So everybody knows that I have poor performance in my laboratory. So the benefits have been described in other slides. So I go through because we are running out of time. Thank you very much for your attention. If there is a question from your side, I will be answering them. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Dehnad, for this presentation. Now, with the time left, we will go ahead with some questions. Therefore, if you have any question, it's time to ask them. Please use the comment box or raise your hand function. Thank you. Okay, Mr. Dehnad, here we have the first question. The first question is, what is the purpose of proficiency testing?
The purpose of proficiency testing is to assure that the results reported by the laboratory are reliable. So by participation in proficiency testing, I can assure all the interested parties that the laboratory produces technically valid results.
Thank you very much. We have another question. The last question, actually. How proficiency testing can improve laboratory performance?
By participation in proficiency testing, we may identify some problems within our lab. For example, I participate in proficiency testing and after the evaluation of the performance, we notice that our performance was poor. So we go through and investigate the case and we see that the result was because the preventive maintenance of one instrument has not been done very efficiently. So in that case, we plan a maintenance program again and we run that maintenance program so such a problem won't happen for future cases.
We have here Mr. Wedderburn that he has raised his hand. So I will unmute his mic and he's going to have his question.
Okay.
Please, Mr. Wedderburn, you may have your word. it seems like his microphone is not working or some another issue. So we do not have any other question. That was all for today.
Okay.
Because of the time limited, we will go with. Thank you very much, Mr. Dehnad, for this clear and informative presentation. I want to thank all attendees as well for taking the time out of your busy schedules to join us today. We hope you enjoyed the webinar. To keep up with our webinars, please check PECB webinars schedule in our website www.pecb.com or our official social network. Since next week we are organizing webinars on interesting topics. Next Tuesday we are going to host a webinar on topic implementing a new QMS improvement system. Thank you very much to all of you. Bye-bye.